This conference will now be recorded.
Next to save chip. Recording save chip. Good morning, students. Today's class, systemic mycosis. Okay. For you, already subcutaneous superficial mycosis finished. This is systemic. Then you have another type of mycosis, I mean fungal infection, opportunistic mycosis. Okay, today's topic, systemic mycosis. Systemic mycosis means a group of fungi causes infections in deep, I mean for viscera and organs. Okay, what is the definition of superficial mycosis? Superficial means they confined only to superficial layers like skin and other fascia and all. But here subcutaneous means they involve only subcutaneously. Then coming to systemic, this is also called deep mycosis. So coming to introduction, in this systemic mycosis involve multiple organs. Okay, mostly they are caused by the saprophytic fungi. Okay, all the causative agents, a group of fungi responsible for this systemic mycosis are dimorphic fungi. What is dimorphism? Anybody? What is dimorphism? Dimorphic means single organism, I mean single fungi can be exist in two forms. One is yeast form in host and on cultures at 37 degrees centigrade. And another second form is mycelial or hyphae form. This hyphal form or mycelial form exists in soil and at the temperature 20 to 25 degrees centigrade. Okay, this is the definition of dimorphic fungi. Very, very important. This definition very, very important for 2 marks viva with examples. Okay, so all the systemic infections, mycological infections are caused by a group of dimorphic fungi. Okay, all these are saprophytic fungi. Saprophytes means they are they exist in nature. They are widely distributed in nature, in soil and in spores and in the form of spores like that. Okay, and common route of transmission is these are spread by inhalation of spores. Okay, and usually all the systemic infections primarily leading to pulmonary infection. Okay, see here small logic. Route of transmission is by inhalation. So first involving organism, sorry, organ here is lungs. So pulmonary infection, some from lungs to disseminate infection cause means from lungs these organisms in the form of spores spread to every organ. Okay, and cause disseminate infections. Okay, so in normal persons, healthy persons, I mean immunocompetent host, these infections can stop, means can recover up to lungs only. But in case of immunocompromised patients, especially patients with very low cell-mediated immunity, these infections leads to, I mean, disseminate to several organs and cause severe complications. Okay, this is about superficial, I mean, systemic mycosis. Here, one definition: subcutaneous plus systemic mycosis, collectively called deep mycosis. Okay, sometimes in exams they may ask, write in detail about deep mycosis. So subcutaneous and systemic mycosis, collectively called deep mycosis. Next, here major four fungal agents cause these systemic mycological infections. In this, first one is histoplasmosis. Histoplasmosis is infection. Histoplasmosis is caused by Histoplasma capsulatum. And then second one is blastomycosis. This is caused by Blastomyces dermatitis. Okay, then another third fungal agent is coccidioidomycosis. This is caused by Coccidioides immitis. Coccidioides immitis. Then another fourth one, last one, paracoccidioidomycosis. Causative agent is paracoccidioides resiliensis. Okay, I am repeating: Histoplasma capsulatum, Blastomyces dermatitis, Coccidioides immitis, paracoccidioides resiliensis. These are the four major fungal agents responsible for systemic mycosis. Among all these, a very important and very common one is histoplasmosis. This is very, very important for you. 4 marks. Okay, Histoplasma capsulatum, causative agent of systemic mycosis, histoplasmosis. See, first one, histoplasmosis. Okay, we already discussed, this is a systemic disease, systemic granulomatous disease. Then this is a primary disease of reticuloendothelial system. Okay, this is caused by a dimorphic fungi, Histoplasma capsulatum. This Histoplasma capsulatum is intracellular parasite. This histoplasmosis also known as Darling's disease, because this was first reported by Samuel Darling in 1905. That's why this disease also called Darling's disease. Next, source. The fungus inhabits in the humid and acidic soils that contains large amount of birds, especially pigeons or bat droppings. Okay, the soil, humid soil is the source of infection here. That the soil contaminate with the spores of this Histoplasma capsulatum excreted by birds and bats, especially pigeons. Okay, this is the source. Next, coming to the mode of transmission. Mode of transmission, we already discussed, through inhalation. Okay, here infective spores, infective form spore is Microconidia. Okay, because of the inhalation of these Microconidia, histoplasmosis occur. Next, coming to pathogenesis. If you see the pathogenesis, here small important tip is, this pathogenesis is similar to all four organisms. Okay, coming to pathogenesis, after the spores enter into the lungs, they are engulfed by macrophages. Inside the lung, engulfed by alveolar macrophages. Okay, inside this macrophage, phagolysosome, inside the phagolysosome, this mycelial form, spores, Microconidia, transform into yeast forms. Okay, why? We already discussed, this is dimorphic fungi. So in host, I mean host means here human, host, and at 37 degrees it can exist as yeast form, host to yeast, that is the tip. Okay, in host and in culture at 37 degrees it can exist as a yeast form. That's why after entry inside the alveolar macrophages, immediately this spore converted into yeast form. Okay, spore means this is in mycelial form. Okay, after entry converted into where this spores inhalation of through inhalation from where source of infection here is soil. So in the soil, these are in the mycelial form. So after entry inside the alveolar macrophages, okay, in alveolar macrophages, within macrophage, in phagolysosome, at that stage, this convert into yeast form. This spore form is converted into yeast form. Okay. So then after that, what happened? This intracellular yeast traveled to the lymph nodes and spread to the other parts of the body through bloodstream. Okay. So after that, what happened? If persons with normal CMI, means cell-mediated immunity, means immunocompetent patients, what happened? Granulomatous are formed, which later get healed with fibrosis and calcification. Okay, this cycle up to here happened in normal person, means immunocompetent host. Okay, if it is person with a low, very low CMI, okay, persons with patients with very low CMI, examples are transplantation patients, then HIV patients, patients under chemotherapy. All these are the examples for patients with low, very low CMI, cell-mediated immunity. So what happened in that cases? What happened? This spores, I mean yeast form, disseminated to several organs and cause disseminated infection. So, and leads to several complications. Okay, up to here happened in healthy persons, immunocompetent host. Okay, see here second point, intracellular yeast traveled to the lymph nodes and spread to the other parts of the body through bloodstream. But here cell-mediated immunity can resist the pathogenesis here, so they can lead normal life. But in case of person with low CMI, this disseminated infection leads to several complications. This is about pathogenesis of histoplasmosis. Next, coming to the clinical manifestations. Histoplasmosis causes asymptomatic infection to life-threatening illness. Okay, two extremes. Symptomatic infection mainly seen in immunocompetent host, okay, people with very good immunity. Then it leads to other extreme, life-threatening illness. This life-threatening illness, these are happens only in the people with low cell-mediated immunity. Okay, if we see the clinical manifestations, mainly three types. First one is pulmonary histoplasmosis. This is the most common form, and acute form presents with mild flu-like illness. Okay, if we see the chest x-ray, we can see Heller or mediastinal lymphadenopathy. Okay, then common symptoms, general symptoms like fever, anemia, and hepatosplenomegaly also present. Then in some rare cases, mainly smokers with underlying lung diseases have chronic cavitary histoplasmosis. This chronic cavitary histoplasmosis we can see in only in smokers with underlying structural lung disease. Okay, this is about pulmonary histoplasmosis. Next, coming to the mucocutaneous histoplasmosis. Mucocutaneous means mainly common sites are skin and oral mucosal lesions. These may develop secondary to pulmonary infection. Remember this point. These are not primary symptoms, primary manifestations. These mucocutaneous lesions develops secondary to pulmonary infection. Okay, these oral lesions are particularly seen in Indian patients. See, these are the lesions, oral lesions. These are particularly seen in Indian patients because of the histoplasma capsulatum. Next, third one is disseminated histoplasmosis. It develops if CMI is, I mean, CMI means cell-mediated immunity is very low. We already discussed this point. Okay, the common sites affected are bone marrow, spleen, liver, eyes, and adrenal glands. This is about histoplasmosis. Next, coming to the laboratory diagnosis. Here, specimens are sputum aspirate from bone marrow and lymph node, blood and biopsies from skin and mucosa. Okay, we already discussed several times specimens, type of specimens always depends on clinical manifestations and pathogenesis. Okay, direct microscopy, past periodic acid skin stain, genes are, and right stains are using present. Okay, see here, very important. From primary smear, primary smear means direct smear from the infected site, appears as a small. So here we can see the morphological form, which type of morphological form. Here we can take smear from patient, so host, so we can see the yeast forms, intracellular yeast forms. See morphology, appears as a small oval yeast cells, okay, packed within the cytoplasm of the macrophages or monocytes with the diameter of 2 to 4 microns. This is very important. We already discussed in the host, always this dimorphic fungi is in yeast form. So in from host, always we can see these yeast form only, yeast cells, okay, appears as a small yeast cells packed within the cytoplasm of the macrophages or monocytes. Next, coming to the culture. Okay, specimen should be inoculated onto media. Two types of media, we are using two types of media here. One is SDA, saprolactone agar, and blood agar, and mainly BHA, brain hot infusion agar, in duplicate. Means one set we can inoculate, we should inoculate at 37 degrees. Another set we should must and should inoculate at 25 degrees. Okay, because this is dimorphic fungi. So after incubation, we can see at 25 degrees it forms mycelial phase, produce white to buff brown colonies that consist of, okay, if we prepare LPCB mold from that white to buff brown colonies, consist of large 8 to 20 micrometer thickness, thick walled spherical spores with tubercle or finger like projection. This is the morphology of mycelial form of Histoplasma capsulatum. Okay, at 37 degrees centigrade we can see yeast form. Okay, see, this is the, this picture showing intracellular, within the cell, intracellular yeast cells, small yeast cells present within the cytoplasm of this cell, macrophage or monocyte. See, this is picture from primary smear. See, this is the mycelial form. These are the mycelia with finger-like, see, tubular or finger-like, tubercular or finger-like projections. These are the spores. This is the mycelial form. Okay, this is LPCB, lactophenol cotton blue preparation. This is the Histoplasma capsulatum on SDA, saprolactone agar. See, buff, white to buff or brown color growth. So this is about Histoplasma capsulatum morphology and culture. So, and serological test, we can detect the antibodies by complement fixation test and immunodiffusion test. So for this, for the demonstration of histoplasmosis, we have skin test, means skin test also available. Okay, to, it is for the demonstration of delayed type hypersensitivity, mainly by using the histoplasmin antigen. Coming to the treatment, amphotericin B and itraconazole, these two are the drug of choice. So this histoplasmosis is very, very important for you. Next, coming to the second systemic mycosis, blastomycosis. Okay, this is caused by Blastomyces dermatoides. Okay, other names of this disease are Gilchrist disease. Okay, Gilchrist disease or Chicago disease. Gilchrist, I think cricketer name also Gilchrist. I heard. Okay, Gilchrist disease or Chicago disease. This is caused by dimorphic fungi, and this is endemic in North America. Coming to pathogenesis, transmitted by same route, inhalation of the conidia. Spores enter into the lung and are engulfed by alveolar macrophages, then where they get converted into yeast phase. Common, this point is common for all systemic mycosis. Coming to the clinical manifestations, this cause acute pulmonary blastomycosis. This is the most common form. Acute pulmonary blastomycosis, this is common form, and it can lead to other extra pulmonary manifestations. Include skin involvement is the most common. This is characterized by either varicose or ulcerative type of skin lesions. I mean, warty type of or ulcerate type of skin lesions in this case. Okay, osteomyelitis, and in men, prostate involvement also there. Then mainly persons with HIV, center most more prone to get CNS blastomycosis. Okay, these are the clinical manifestations of blastomycosis. Coming to laboratory diagnosis, specimens, sputum, pus, and scrapings from skin. Okay, direct microscopy, 10% KOH mount. Okay, in 10% KOH mount preparation, we can see thick-walled yeast cells with a single broad-based bud bench. See, these are the yeast forms of Blastomyces dermatoides. Okay, see, with the broad-based bud. Then we can use eosin and hematoxin stains and periodic acid skiffa stain. Okay, on culture at 25 degrees, mycelial form containing hyphae with small pear-shaped conidia. See, these are the hyphal form. This is the yeast, this is the mycelial hyphae, septated hyphae with the small microconidia, pear-shaped microconidia. Okay, this form, yeast form, we can see at 37 degrees and host, this we can see at 25 degrees. Okay, treatment, amputation B and itraconazole. These two are the drug of choice. So this is about blastomycosis. Next, third one, coccidioid mycosis. This is also called desert rheumatism or valley fever or California fever. Okay, this coccidioid mycosis caused by Coccidioides immitis. Coccidioides immitis. Next, pathogenesis. This is transmitted by inhalation of arthroconidia. Here, important point is this arthroconidia is rectangular shape conidia, very, very, very dangerous. Okay, these are very infectious conidia. Same procedure next. In lungs, they enlarge, become rounded, and develop internal septations. Okay, so after entering into the lung, this arthroconidia in the lungs enlarge. Okay, these are usually in square shape. After entry, they enlarge and become rounded, round shape, and develop internal septations. Means within the conidia, arthroconidia, septations occur, develop into form large sac-like structures of size up to 10 to 200 microns called spherules. Okay, These are called spherules, that each spherule consists of numerous spores called endospores. Okay, here one important viva question. Name two fungi causes produce endospores. Exospores, endospores. Usually all fungi can produce exospores, means these Arthroconidia, Microconidia, Macroconidia, all these are the exospores. Here endospores, these coccidioides imitis form endospores, I mean they develop into spherules. Within spherules, it contains so many numerous endospores. So these are called endospores. So here one is coccidioides imitis, another one is Rhinosporidium seberi. Rhinosporidium seberi, that one also produce endospores. These two are the example for endospore producing bacteria. Next, these spherules may rupture and release packets of endospores that can disseminate and develop into new spherules. Okay, this is like a life cycle. See here. See, this is spherule formation. This one is single. Then this is arthrospores. This arthrospores, after entry into the host in alveolar macrophage, they enlarge and become round. See, inside that striations, septations develop, and see. So this is mature spherule with numerous endospores. Okay, then this spherule rupture and release these endospores into tissues, and each endospore become another spherule. Like that it will process. Okay, so this is about coccidioides imitis. Coming to the clinical manifestations, most patients are asymptomatic. Okay, and in some patients we can see pulmonary coccidioidomycosis is present with pneumonia, cavities formation, pleural effusion or nodule formation. Then here important point, this happens only in women, particularly this secondary to pulmonary infection, not primary manifestation. Skin lesions such as rashes or erythema nodosum and arthritis with joint pain occurs secondary to pulmonary infection, particularly in women. Okay, this is very very important point here. Next, common sites for dissemination. So usually this infect confined to pulmonary coccidioidomycosis. Then in some patients, especially in women, it leads to skin lesions. We already discussed rashes, erythema, nodosum and joint pains, arthritis with joint pains. Okay, if persons with low CMI, cell mediated immunity, this infection disseminate into several organs including skin, joints, bone, soft tissues and meninges. Okay, these are the different clinical manifestations produced by coccidioides imitis. Next, coming to the laboratory diagnosis. Okay, here specimens are sputum or tissue biopsy specimens. Okay, direct microscopy, we can see spherules which are large sac like structure, have thick double refractal wall and are filled with endospores. We already discussed, I already showed you this one. Is we can see the this stage morphological form from host specimen. Okay, spherules with endospores, this morphological form we can see under microscope. Okay, double layered refractal wall filled with numerous endospores. Culture SDA at 37 degrees east at 25 degrees mycelial phase contains pseudo hyphae which fragment into arthrospores. we already discussed these are square shaped spores, very 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 highly infectious. So that's why this Coccidioides immitis should culture on SDA in tube, okay, should not cultivate on SDA plate because of the highly infectious nature of arthrospores. Next, last systemic mycosis is paracoccidioidic mycosis. Okay, causative fungi is Paracoccidioides brasiliensis. Okay, this coming to the pathogenesis and clinical manifestations, this is transmitted by inhalation of spores, which then transform into the yeast phase in the lungs. Okay, I already told in the beginning, this point is common for every systemic mycosis, systemic mycological infection. Next, this clinical manifestation for this paracoccidioides is in the two forms. One is acute form or juvenile type, means name itself indicates acute or juvenile type. It affects young adults under 30 years of age. It is a less common variety but more severe form. This acute or juvenile type paracoccidioidal mycosis is less common, very rare, occurs young adults under 30 years of age, but more severe form. It manifests as disseminated infection involving multiple viscera. Okay. Next, coming to the second form, chronic or adult form. Okay, this we can see predominantly seen, mainly affects older men. And this is less severe form, manifested as progressive pulmonary disease affecting lower lobes and ends with fibrosis. Okay, this is less severe form, chronic form. This is also called adult form. Skin oral mucosal lesions and cervical lymphadenopathy also present. Next, coming to the laboratory diagnosis, specimens are sputum, pus, and tissue biopsies. With the direct microscopy with KOH mount, we can see numerous yeast cells with multiple birds. See, this is the paracoccidioides brasiliensis yeast form, numerous multiple birds. This is mycelial form at 25 degrees. So this is about systemic mycosis. Okay, systemic mycosis, it is the infection of deep tissues or organs. Okay, not confined, not restricted to superficial layer or superficial. Okay, that's why it is called systemic mycosis. A group of fungi causes systemic mycosis are all are dimorphic fungi. Dimorphism means it can exist in two forms, yeast and mycelial form. Okay, in the systemic mycosis, histoplasmosis, blastomycosis, coccidioid mycosis, paracoccidioid mycosis. Okay, these are four systemic mycosis infections. Okay, systemic fungal infection. Among all these, histoplasmosis is very very important for you. Okay, this is about systemic mycosis.